Hello, hello everyone. I am Prerna Dadu, and we're back with another episode here at the Unredacted podcast. We're going to be talking to Anshuma Kshetrapal, and we're going to be discussing mental health and pop culture and how pop culture is impacting our mental health and also the discourse of mental health on pop culture. So hopefully it's going to be a good ride. Thank you for coming here with us and taking the time to talk.
Thank you for having me, and I'm very excited that your podcast is taking out time to review this very important topic.
The pandemic, we saw a lot of people staying at home and mostly just consuming TV because there was not much else to do. So there was a spike in people watching web series or subscriptions to OTT platforms. Netflix saw a jump in its subscription and more content being churned out every single day. Apart from this, Instagram, Facebook, and all of these other social networking sites have seeped into our daily being. It's every second that we have off. Our morning tea is now with our phone by the hand, or a trip to the washroom is with the phone. Like, phone it's a part of us. It doesn't leave our side. And it is our gateway to the world and how it connects us to the world. Everything we know about ourselves and everything around us has been given us through this wonderful thing, internet. And so because so many more people have been consuming so much more content every day, I was wondering if there have been some mental health impacts of consuming so much content that you have seen as a therapist or you've dealt with.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, to put it very broadly, I think what you're talking about has something to do with how we engage with our surroundings, and how when our surroundings become too painful to engage with, we are using these alternate realities to escape to. And I think that we have to ask ourselves the questions. Somewhere around, is our existence so painful to engage with that we're having to shift realities every second, that we can't have 5 seconds free just in case we actually delve into what is really happening around us? So those are some of the thoughts that I've been also pondering because of like you said, this overconsumption of media. It really seems to have shifted during the pandemic, but even pre-pandemic. The rise in cases of insomnia and just anxiety around was all being satiated by the internet and content consumption. So it was already happening. It's just that, this dissociation is the new normal is a really worrying kind of a factor. And of course, there's a lot of it in a certain segment of society which has grown up with it. But really, we're seeing it in our parents, we're seeing it in our children, we're seeing it in society as at large. What is abnormal now is to engage in real-time conversation and have actual eye contact. We can't I remember very recently I met someone who was talking about how people's breathing has started to bother them, that just people breathing around me is, I'd rather just engage over the screen. I don't want someone breathing around me or rustling around me, or those small little things have started to bother me. Now, I was thinking about how these micro sounds have become so cumbersome, so bothersome. Even right now, as you and I are having this conversation, there is an anxiety around, oh, I hope my pressure cooker doesn't go off. So my real world is actually causing me anxiety. I'm so careful about protecting this virtual world from all signals of the real world that I almost want to erase that. And I want to exist here. And what you said about platforms, right? I want to dissociate in different ways. I want to create a new reality every time I engage with a new platform. I want my identity to be so morphed that I engage with you over three or four platforms, and all platforms I'm having a different conversation with you. Mm. I'm talking to you over work, about work on WhatsApp, while I'm commenting on your picture on Instagram, while I'm engaging with a Facebook post that you've shared about some political echo chamber that we share. So all these conversations have actually got nothing to do with each other, and I'm engaging with the same people through different aspects and parts of myself. And if you think about it, where is a consolidated, integrated person? Who is the individual who is having this conversation, and which one is the reality? Becomes the question. So yeah, at some point, Prerna, I feel like we're going to look back at this time, just like we look back at the time when cigarettes had come up. Mm-hmm. And at that time, everybody was smoking everywhere, right? Airplanes and children were smoking, and it was all fine. And gradually research proved the harmful effects. I'm wondering if the same thing is going to happen with internet, where, you know, our next few generations will look back and say, what do you mean? The internet was just free to use, but it's addictive. It's got so much toxic shit on it. How are we just using it, you know, like that?
That's an interesting comparison. Overwhelming amount of content that is now being made available to us. Is there a recent trend in the kind of content that you've been seeing that's been bothering you as a professional?
The thing is, it's the consumer is the producer now. And so what happens is there's a lot of relatability. So the same things that are bothering me are perhaps also relieving in some ways. So for example, this genre of dank comedy, right? Why is it relieving? Because it feels like people are able to grasp something hot and heavy and bothersome and have fun with it and make it light and engage with it in a playful manner. And so that offers relatability. You're able to talk about things that you weren't able to talk about earlier. You're able to express yourself in this way. It's a very good experience for your body to have, to be able to hold the tension and then release it with laughter. But why is it bothering me is because, is it normalizing some aspects which are perhaps not okay? Some aspects which are actually pathology.
Is there a particular comedian that you're thinking of?
Are you? Yeah. I refuse to name names and get into this
controversy. Yeah.
But it's true, right? It's true. It's true that, you know, certain images, certain aspects, certain things are getting normalized, which perhaps we should retain the shock value of. Perhaps there's a reason our bodies and minds react with shock, and by exposing ourselves constantly to that content, when we normalize it, we're saying that it's okay for us to go through, I don't know, gore and, you know, all these other things that even the news channels, they're constantly trying to grab eyeballs by doing that, but aren't they normalizing this?
The point that you were saying about somebody now has a problem with people breathing around them, it reminds me of this Bo Burnham's Inside, where he talks about the outside is now limited to what you want from it. You go out to get your groceries, you go out to attend this very important, like maybe your doctor or your post office or whatever, but at the end of the day you come back and you live your life inside. And and so now then TVs are just your gateway to the world. That is your, how you access the world. So now, do you think that that is now a problem? Are we, the fact that we're accessing the outside only through our screens, is that affecting our mental health? Is there even a link there?
The transition spaces between places, physical places, gave us something which allowed us to prepare in a certain way to enter a new reality. So when I left my home and I got into my car and I went to the doctors, that was not an empty space. There was something in my mind that was, you know, preempting what's going to happen, preparing my body, preparing things that I will be able to, how do I function in this new reality? I'm constantly thinking. And now that I'm seeing, especially when people are coming to therapy, this is extremely relevant, that they're in their bedroom, they're oppressors, and sometimes, you know, the family members, that are the problem are right in the room with them, and then they're having to create this alternate reality quickly by switching on the screen, right? And they switch off the screen and then again, and I'm like, that seeping in period that the mind required, the preparation and then the de-escalation from that, you know, that that kind of like almost like a wave pattern that we go towards something, we create something, and then we come back from it. That those transitional spaces have gone missing as we just, you know, switch Zoom rooms to enter different realities and become different people. In one room, I'm a teacher. In the other room, I'm a friend. In the third room, I'm attending a wedding. In the fourth room, I'm, you know, a therapist. And all of them exist while I'm sitting in one space, which can be termed convenience, but really what it's doing to my brain and my mind as I'm jerked around to these realities. And in the middle of all of that, I'm checking my Instagram and I can't even go to the shower without turning on my television or at least music. So these kind of like this human mind's experience. Now just think of the, like, think of the mind as if it was a physical entity, right? And the image I have is of this physical entity just being pulled and pushed in all directions. And that's what we're doing to our bodies and our minds and our realities. That we're just shoving ourselves into things without being fully prepared. We're shoving outside. We're going here. We're not letting anything sink and settle. We have no memory anymore. We have no attention span anymore because there is no transition out or in into anything.
Right. And it, I'm sure it's not helpful to be receiving negative news at all times. If we're switching from one media platform to the other, even say if, when I switch from Tumblr to Twitter, which is two very opposing things, there is still like in a 10-second scroll, I'm bound to encounter something that's really tragic that's happened and things that will just for a second put you off. But also the very next second is a very funny meme. And so do you think like that also, ki, that 10 second may tragedy, 10 second may comedy is, what do you think of that? Like the, just the format of the way you consume news.
Yeah, our hormones are being played around with because of that, right? Because our health is being played around with to grab eyeballs, because these channels and these mediums understand that to get the most amount of views, they should create that adrenaline spike. They should create that cortisol in our palpitations, our sweaty palms. They should be able to create that sort of a situation for us to even not just randomly scroll, but to stick around for that 3-second window. Or I think it's now 0.08 seconds, some random window, and double tap our screens to like. To grab that, they need to create a shift in our hormones. So what my body is, when my body is shocked or when my body is bursting into laughter, that's when I'm interacting and engaging. So to constantly want engagement, the creators have to constantly, you know, create that clickbait, create that kind of anxiety in me. It's all anxiety at the end of the day, right? So unless anxiety is created, I'm not engaging with the medium. So what I'm doing is then I'm constantly anxious because my hormones are constantly going from one state to another again without any transition in or out. So it's not entirely healthy. And at the same time, it's become normal. So what happens to someone who doesn't engage with that? How ostracized and what shame does that individual face? FOMO becoming almost a medical term now. It's something that's constantly in my sessions. I'm always hearing about the fear of missing out.
Because you're constantly reminded of the people that you could be and the places that you could be in. And so you're just never satisfied with your reality.
Nothing is ever going to be good enough because you're all constantly looking at the highlight reels of everybody else's lives, considering that to be their reality, which we all know it isn't. But then there is constantly a comparison scale. And so you'll hear people who are getting off of Instagram or getting almost, they behave like they're ex-addicts, you know. They're saying, oh, I've such relief. Thank God I'm not in that world.
Yeah.
And what does that tell us about our world?
It's the place you don't want to be in.
Dissociation is the new normal.
What is this term? Like, why have you been hearing this so often? And why is this a problem, disassociation?
Dissociation essentially was a trauma response, really. Now, I wouldn't vilify it because it is a way of your mind protecting itself from extreme trauma. So when you undergo extreme trauma, the mind decides to dissociate you so that you're not staying in that feeling for so long and feeling so overwhelmed, so that you can become distanced from it, objective about it. And maybe that objectivity can actually help you create some sort of a solution.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so when our mind goes into fight, flight, freeze, and we have to take those decisions, often instead of engaging with the danger, the mind will dissociate mm-hmm. so that we can take those decisions.
Mm-hmm.
But what's happening now is there is no engagement. There is consistent dissociation. So that becomes a problem because then you're staying in a state of stress. And the human body isn't designed to stay in a state of stress. So what we're seeing now with these heart attacks in young people and these blood pressure issues and everything else, I'm just saying the body is just not designed for the way we've created our societies and our universes to look like. We're not supposed to be behaving in these ways. So we're going against the natural order of things.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, we're supposed to engage with our realities. We're supposed to engage with our sensations, not only of sight, but also of smell and touch. And all these things we're sort of leaving behind.
Yeah.
And we're just engaging in these fleeting ways without anything stoic or solid. And so we're not able to really have memory either, because you can't associate. Associations are formed when you have emotions attached to something. For forming emotions and relationships and engagement, you need time.
Mm.
And since we're not giving ourselves that time, we're not engaged. So tomorrow, if you ask me about this conversation, maybe I won't remember it.
Yeah.
Then what, right?
Yeah, true. Do you think when, say, Mark Zuckerberg was creating this platform, obviously did not envision Facebook to become this all-consuming social media giant, helping third world countries rig elections and whatever, promote violence. Mm-hmm. So do you think the success of such a platform is also attributable to some part of human nature that wants to exist in isolation bubbles?
I'm not sure about this want, I'll tell you. So I actually did my first master's thesis on this. And that time I met and interviewed this wonderful woman called Dr. Sherry Turkle, who's written this book called Alone Together. And this was before all of these other platforms, only Facebook existed. I'm talking 2008, 2009. And I think what she was prophesizing then about this human condition was, there's going to be extreme loneliness, and isn't there? Wouldn't you say loneliness is also an epidemic
mm-hmm.
at this point of time? So really, with so much engagement, if you're still lonely,
mm-hmm.
then that should be a marker for this being an issue, that we're clearly not engaging in a way which is meaningful.
Yeah.
And it is not engaging in a way that is actually providing any value to either of us.
Mm-hmm.
Then what's the point of this platform, that platform, etc.?
Mm.
I think when it was created not as an alternative to reality,
mm.
but a supplementary service, a complementary service. And as long as it remains that,
mm.
we have less chance of feeling this level of aloneness. Mm. But as soon as it displaces reality, then what we are seeing now is these really isolated, suffering, isolated people who are engaging with their thousands of friends on Facebook, Instagram, etc., but then breaking down just because they're so isolated and lonely.
Coming back to pop culture.
Hey, you invited a mental health professional. What were you expecting?
You know, expected the this, didn't expect a call out. Okay, so see, the first time I heard a conversation about mainstream portrayal of mental health was after Dear Zindagi came out. And that's when I think mental health also became a discussion that was being had at a national forum at a public level. And there were a lot of just like disagreements about the way it is being done and everything. So as a mental health professional, what is your take on the depiction of mental health in pop culture?
The thing with depiction of pop, I'm going to come at it from an arts therapy perspective as well, because I am an arts therapist, I am a drama therapist, I'm a movement therapist. So I understand the exaggeration that sometimes an art form has to do to highlight certain things and to grab eyeballs, to function as, you know, to seek attention in some ways so they can, you know. And most of these stories we're seeing, except for Dear Zindagi, there are a lot of other stories where the mental health function is not the main story. It's part of something. So it serves a certain function. Like, I think I saw Decoupled and I was quite horrified with how the therapist was presented. Or there was also this other show, Hunger Games. No, Sacred Games. What? Sacred Games. Yeah. And I did not understand. But then if I look at it, at the show as a whole, the therapist is playing a function to move along the plot line.
Yeah.
So the therapy is not the story of the... So at that point, I have to learn to forgive. But also I'm thinking, even about Dear Zindagi, it wasn't the most ethical portrayal of a therapist. It's not the reality. Our realities are very dull. Our realities are not so glamorous. Our realities are, we have dents in our chairs because of how much we sit, and we don't take walks along the beaches, and we don't fix bikes while we're talking to our patients, and we don't have gyan to give. So our realities are very much about listening and about receiving. And how unattractive will that be? What a stupid show would that be, right? Like, if somebody's just, the show is about somebody sitting in a chair and listening. Not to say some powerful work happens, wonderful work happens, but to show this really nuanced thing is very difficult to portray. So while I forgive them, I also have a lot of issues with how mental health is being portrayed. And I think it's one of those things where how much unethical things am I okay with just because at least it's bringing up the conversation. I'm so tired of that being the excuse. At least it's promoting the conversation. At least it's brought up. Yes, but it's brought up the conversation in a way that, again, we'll have to do another 50 years of work to break that down.
Yeah.
And to promote it in the right way. So, you know, does the means justify the end? Or does the end justify the means in this way?
True.
So, no, I'm not happy.
We do see just like elite privileged classes getting therapy, wearing these really fancy clothes, going to these really fancy offices. And obviously that's not the way mental health works. That's not how advocacy works for mental health either. So but what about shows like BoJack or any other show that you've been a fan of their mental health portrayal?
I mean, there have been several moments in certain shows where I've just felt that moment was a certain really well done portrayal. And what's that movie with Robin Williams and Matt Damon? I wouldn't be able to have many contemporary examples, but there are certain times and moments in which the portrayal has been bang on. And then, of course, once again, it'll depart from that portrayal because, you know, there's...
Yeah.
Did you get the name of the movie?
Goodwill Hunting.
Goodwill Hunting, yes, of course. I'm very bad with names, so you'll have to forgive me. So there is, but let me tell you this, and also bring it back home. You know, there are certain stark realities in which the infrastructure in this country is so unsupportive to mental health work that, you know, I'm not surprised at our portrayal being so shabby in some ways. that it isn't because that's how some of the pockets of work is actually looking like that. So it is reflecting a portion of reality. And so good therapy will be shown in shows where there are rich people going to good therapists who are having to sit in plush offices, because guess what? Nobody's paying us. There is no funding for mental health. There is no insurance for mental health. So what ends up happening is that this elite portrayal is the reality of urban situations, where in order to survive and make a living, mental health professionals have to shift their focus and their practices to serving the elite, so that those people who are willing to pay, but the other section of society, even though we really want to, and some of us go to great lengths, we offer sliding scales, we offer low fee slots, we offer no fee pro bono slots, but why should we have to? Nobody else asks this of any other profession, that why don't you provide a few hours of your work for free every week? Why should we have to? We're one, not recognized by the government. Two, we're not recognized in that. That's what gives us shoddy education sometimes. The cream of the country does not go into mental health work because there is no infrastructure to support it. So why would you sign up for something, you know, which, so what is happening is sometimes these courses are filled up with students who just want to pass and don't have ambition to pursue it. And then those of us who have the ambition to pursue it, you know, as you're going along, in my MA class, there were 60 students. I know maybe three of them that are still practicing, four maybe. Because to practice, you have to be an entrepreneur. You have to, you know, figure out your own way. You have to have some amount of capital from your parents or your support system in a way that is able to support you in this profession, because the profession won't support you right away. So there are so many infrastructural issues in which this framework just falls apart.
Yeah.
That I'm not surprised that the media portrayal isn't accurate.
Yeah, that makes sense. And there's also like a fundamental flaw in that, right? Because if you're asking mental health professionals to give pro bono slots, then there is some understanding that this is a universal right that people deserve. People deserve to have a healthy mind. And you would believe that they should receive it at no cost. So clearly that understanding is there, but there is, on the flip side of it, to actually help actualize it, there is no realization on that bit of it. So, I mean, that's very ironic.
There's also a very strange cultural nuance involved here, Prerna, where, and I've been asked this by a journalist recently, who said, how can you charge money for this? This is God's work. Or something about it being pro bono just makes sense, because after all, you're just talking. So there's a certain lack, certain ignorance around the work itself also that promotes this culture. And so until that is there, so it's a cycle, right? So it's a vicious cycle then. Because there's ignorance, there isn't the framework. And because there's no framework, there is ignorance.
So I want to ask, so during the 2 years of pandemic, we saw the pandemic, obviously, of course. And then there were just things that were happening one after the other with, say, Shashank Rajput's death, with the Khaurigaon rape case, with the farmers' protest. There were just things that were going wrong in the country one after the other. And there was no other choice but to tune in and listen to it, because there was nothing else you could do. And there was this 2 years, or maybe 2 years is a long, but 1 year, in which news was moving in tandem, where everybody was just focused on one thing at the same time. So do you think that itself, like just that 1 year, and with everything that went down, even like the Amazon burning, like just a bunch of things went wrong. So do you think that itself has, like, what is a post-pandemic mental health of an average, I mean, I don't know what average is, but I mean, what does it look like? What do the minds of post-pandemic people look like?
I think the pandemic took away our distractions, and our pace of life was deliberately slowed down, and it was made, we were made to focus on certain things. And I think that there were a lot of realizations. Now, again, and I don't want to be dividing things into binaries. There is a spectrum here, but I have a feeling that everyone I've engaged with, client, friend, parent, doesn't matter, has had to introspect, has had to look into what do they need and what is happening. And that has led to some things which are great. We see a huge rise in conversations around mental health, especially as a body-based therapist. I started to, after screaming from the rooftops for 10 years, I should add, I started to get actual queries about arts therapies, people asking about movement and drama and the body, and you know how we can use those modalities to express ourselves. Because before this, the body was just seen as an instrument. Let's get up, let's go to work. But now the body started to show symptom. It started to show anxiety and fear and stress. And it start, you had to slow down and your focus became on the body. And the one when you focused, you realized, maybe I need care, you know. Maybe it's trying to tell me something that I haven't been listening to for a long time. So in those ways, these conversations became pertinent. We actually did see a lot of focus. We saw a lot of research happen. We saw the National Commission for Allied Healthcare Professionals coming up, becoming an act in 2021, which was not happening previously. It was a bill since 2016, etc. So there was a lot of focus on mental health. Conversations moved forward. In that way, it's been great. But which is a horrible thing to say in the middle of a pandemic. Because it does feel validating, you know, after shouting, saying this is valid work, to finally have focus on it. But yeah, there was a lot of strife and suffering that led up to that moment. And I think that this slowed down. I really, really hope we don't want to return to the normal we had created. I'm really hoping that everybody keeps talking about going back. We should, you know, when will we go back to our lives? And I'm trying to say, but move forward. Stop trying to go back. That was not working. Right? That's what was highlighted and punctuated and underlined when we all slowed down, that it was not working. And now with this grief and this trauma that this pandemic has brought on, alongside us all slowing down and figuring out that actually it wasn't working, I'm really hoping we're moving forward with some new insight into existence. I think nostalgia is terrible at this point for me. You know, nostalgia makes you look at that time with rose-tinted glasses and think everything was great pre-pandemic and everything was fantastic. It really wasn't.
Yeah.
We were still heading towards depression and anxiety and normalized dissociations. We were still there. So I'm really hoping the pandemic was a punctuation, a comma that helps us gain some insight into things that then help us create something very different now. But let's see. Maybe nostalgia will win. I don't know.
No, I don't think it will, because, you know, like even when you have a bad experience with somebody and you want to break off the relationship, you do block them on social media. Like there is, so I mean, at the essence of it, when you want to move forward, you do have to block the past. I mean, in a way, so a very weird analogy, but I guess hopefully.
No, but I get it. But at the same time, I feel like you just keep thinking of, oh, but some things were so great, you know, so maybe we can give it one more shot. That's what I'm afraid of.
Yeah. All right. So what do you think of these mental health influencers nowadays?
Oh, God. Really? Are we going there? Okay, let's go there.
Yes.
Oh, I mean, I'm so neutral. No, doesn't apply. No. Dear God. I mean, the thing is, okay, here's where I want to start. The intention of reaching out, that's a good intention at any point of time for anyone to have. I want to help. I want to provide space, a listening ear. I want to, I understand that the human mind is suffering. I have privilege. I want to use my privilege to put a good message out there. Great intention. Road to hell is paved with good intention. Because intention alone does not cut it. Intention has to match skill. Now, if that intention leads you to learning more and growing more and doing a master's in the field, and we're seeing that also happen. And really, kudos to those people who are doing that.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And kudos to those therapists who are trying to use these channels to influence people at scale rather than just... This is like World War. You know, when the World War happened, behaviorism and all these wonderful schools of thought came to being because there was suddenly a requirement for mass situation. So this psychoanalysis came out of the elite classes and these one-to-one patterns into becoming group therapy, you know, and having support groups. And all of that took place when the World War happened. So out of strife, people are joining forces to become more skillful and then provide help. But when you skip that step of becoming more skillful, there's danger lurking there. And it is really, truly dangerous to ask someone to be vulnerable without having the capacity and the training to be able to hold them. To ask for vulnerability for your own joy or pleasure or ego massage or whatever else you get out of it. And without introspecting on the power game that it can be, because saying I will help you puts you in a powerful position, assumes that you have the capacity for helping. And then what? You don't really have the capacity for helping. To counter this, actually, me and a colleague of mine, Neha Christopher, we actually started psychological first aid classes during the pandemic. Mm-hmm. And we said, okay, you have the intention to help. Mm-hmm. You're not a therapist, and this course will not make you a therapist. But here's some tips on what you can do, which is to provide psychological first aid.
Mm-hmm.
You will not become their long-term confidant, mm-hmm. and you cannot charge for this,
mm-hmm.
but you can provide psychological first aid.
Mm-hmm.
So we did have a lot of people signing up. In fact, a few doctors signed up, because what they realized is that when people are coming into hospitals, they're now coming in with so much fear and anxiety that even we had a few dentists, we had GPs coming to us who wanted to engage with people and alleviate their fears, give them some basic psychological first aid so that they can be open to treatment. We had influencers who joined. We had so many other people who joined. We had a lawyer in our midst as well who joined in to say that, you know, people are coming in and there's so much fear and anxiety. I just want to be able to get through to them when they're in such traumatic times. And I want to be able to give psychological first aid. But when you're doing that, we also had the countermeasures where counter actions where people were saying, slide into my DMs and for 25 rupees per message, I will give you therapy. And who are these people? Young ones sitting in college and having online classes with nothing to do, I guess. And that's really dangerous, really dangerous. So we did have quite a few very, very botched up cases. One individual who was sitting in one of these Zoom support groups who ended up having a breakdown and trying to take her own life. And the individual who's running this Zoom support group had no idea how they'd, number one, how they'd opened up this Pandora's box. Number two, what to do, how to have a referral pathway. Those of us who are clinicians, we're not just sitting here asking you to be vulnerable. We're sitting here knowing how to hold that vulnerability. And if we are unable to hold that vulnerability, then what are the next steps legally, ethically, medically? What are the next steps? We know this because we're trained in this. Right? So this influencer culture or et cetera, it's great for marketing for mental health, I suppose. But it's not actually delivering mental health services.
But is it good marketing? Like, is the marketing part of it working?
Again and again, like, I don't know, man. I don't know. I don't know whether to make my peace with the influencers and with the deers and the geese of the world too, because at least the conversations are happening. Like, yeah. I don't know. I don't want to, but I don't know what else is my option.
Yeah.
You know, who's really listening to quality, like people who are qualified, who's really seeking that out? I don't know.
Okay. So okay, another sort of dangerous depiction of therapy or mental health that we see is also with the prisoners, say with shows like Orange is the New Black, or even like these OTT platforms that like heavily show police brutality, especially Indian ones like Sacred Games, for example, stuff like that. So how has reformation, you know, being shown of prisoners, like does people, is, when people are talking about how do we give justice, people have different ideas, you know, prisoners need to reform, need to rehabilitate. But there is like zero to nothing conversation around it. And it is one of the biggest failings of a world order in general to not have better prison reform system. So, and I mean, with pop culture, police brutality, and even with news cycles, it's like it's an unsaid truth at this point. Like, I mean, it's an even said truth at this point. Okay, this happens. So is there a way about it? Is there, what do you think about mental health for prisoners?
I think rehabilitation of any sorts is a systemic question. Mm-hmm. And when you are looking at a systemic problem and trying to fix it through an individual intervention, you're missing the point.
Yeah.
You're completely saying that this individual acted in isolation and is not part of a context.
Mm-hmm.
And has existed outside of this universe on another planet and has come and done this. No, but you're missing out on the concept of what led to this moment.
Mm-hmm.
And therefore, the way you have to work is perhaps backwards before you go forwards,
mm-hmm.
which is find out what was the systemic issue that led to this issue and then how do we move forward from here. So when we're looking at representation, now again, here's the problem, Prerna, that people are switching these platforms as if they're all part of reality without forgetting that they're all story-making platforms.
Mm.
All of them are story-making platforms. What does a story require? It requires exaggeration.
Mm.
A story requires a plot point. A story requires a villain. A story requires a hero, right? It requires twists and turns. Otherwise, it won't actually capture attention. So if we forget that, and we start equating everything to reality.
Mm.
Actually, I used to like the, again, I'm old school that way, but I used to like the films because they used to overact so much in those films earlier that you could tell that ye acting hai and ye reality hai. But now we're constantly looking for realistic method actors and all of that, which is great, but it blurs those lines. Right? Mm-hmm. And the producer on Instagram, the producer of information is also the consumer of information. Yeah. And there's those lines are also all blurred, right? Mm-hmm. So who's telling a story and who's telling the reality? Is the news also a real reality now? With so much dramatization and animation and this and that, even that is now a story. So all of this has become like a storytelling method.
Mm-hmm.
And when you're doing that,
hmm.
then whether it's brutality or exaggeration of other formats, it's all has to be amped up so that people will watch it.
Yeah.
What doesn't happen is that people miss the point that those are not supposed to be the reality. So that is a story.
Hmm.
And that reality should be quite different. Hmm. So when I'm considering the reality of our systemic failures, and I'm thinking about how prison reform or any kind of reform has to be looked at minus this reality of the systemic failures. It looks like the fault of the individual and therefore it justifies brutality. When you take anything out of its context and you make it this isolated thing, then you can justify all kinds of cruelty. Because you don't have to look at it in a context. You don't have to look at that as an individual born out of the system. When earlier madness was looked at like this, with the ship of fools, the ship of Theseus.
Mm.
You used to take them out, put them on a ship, and that ship used to sail away to nowhere. Port from port to port to port.
Yeah.
Why? Because society had no resources to cater to these dysfunctional, unfunctional members of society, right? And the same things with prison now. We've just kind of taken them out and left them and said that brutality is okay. And why is that okay? Because they're taken away from society and then they're invisibilized. And so brutality seems okay to do.
The reason I ask about prisoners is because we've been talking about how isolating it is to even not be in prison, but be a prisoner of social media, like microblogging sites. So, I mean, in this, in a sense, it sort of boils down to not having a community to engage with. That if you don't have that one basic access to in life, you're not very likely to grow healthy or to grow into a healthy mind and body.
But realities and these things that we are creating, we also have to take ownership. We can keep blaming a lot of things. We also have to take ownership at some point of how much are we participating in, you know, going towards the sensational and creating these realities in some ways. Because whatever is being studied from a consumer behavior point of view is the engagement that we are doing. So if we continue to engage with that material continues to pop up and becomes part of the algorithm and becomes part. So in that world, is it possible to create a mentally healthy engagement? Perhaps even, is it possible to create that? Maybe not. But actually, I do know of a few certain creative individuals who have very nicely created echo chambers around them that are positive, you know, that they've managed to kind of like remove this sensational. I know this one individual and she really likes slowness. And she uses her entire Instagram. She follows these slow channels. She's deleted her friends and their highlighted lives and all of that. And she just uses her channel to just engage with ASMR and slow things and just, you know, kind of create this sort of compassionate, nurturing environment for herself on online. So it is possible. What I'm trying to tell you is that these channels are nothing but an extension of what we are seeking in some ways. So perhaps the bigger malaise is us seeking that. The channels are also catering to something. The reason they exist and they are perpetuating it is because it exists in the first place. It is possible to, you know, advocate for mental health using these channels. It is possible to create healthy spaces for yourself using this channel.
Like myths about pop culture and mental health that you'd like to bust, like
myths about mental health, pop culture. Number one, influencers are therapists.
Okay.
Please let's bust that myth. Number two, just because I liked a few funny things, I'm clearly not depressed. That's not how depression works. Number three, pop culture is always horrible to our mental health. It doesn't need to be vilified so much. It is created out of society. If you can look at it as a function and a symptom of society, then maybe it's highlighting a problem. If we're kinder to our symptoms, it would be nice, na? If I asked my insomnia, why are you here? What are you here to tell me? You know, instead of saying, oh God, I hate you, insomnia. You're the problem of my life. But if I just said, hey, symptom, what are you doing here? And what can I do to make you feel like you can go away? So maybe we can treat some of these very, very vilified versions of our pop culture like that and just say, hey, you're here to deliver a message and I'm going to try and fix instead of just getting consumed by that message. That would be a wonderful world to live in. That's not happening, but just hoping.
Well, I mean, there's some people that are doing that, aka you.
Oh, gee, thanks. Sure. I'm trying. Yeah, I am.
I mean, I have like 100 different questions, but I mean, I think this is a good stopping point. thank you so much for being here with us. Thank you for shedding a light and giving us a nice cold water bath. I learned a lot from this conversation, as always. Thank you very much.
Thank you for having me. And if it's okay to plug in my podcast as well, It's called Monkey ABC and it's available on all the platforms, especially htsmartcast.com. But the idea with that podcast is perhaps exactly what we're talking about today, is to kind of create like a counterculture around mental health. So all these messaging of these bombardment of messaging, what I do on that podcast is sit with you and talk to you and give you meditations and talk in these, we talk about really soothing things and we, you know, slow down and we relax our bodies 5-10 minutes a day. So it's out every week and it's called Monkey ABC because I'm talking about A, B, C, D karke sare mental health ke topics that I can think of.
Oh, wow.
So yeah, it's just something, you know, to create that kind of content also out there so that that's why I'm trying to not vilify content because I think this is also possible.
Important, yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Pranav. Yeah.